Steve Patt, fellow cider maker. And first we're going to tell you the process we use, and then we have odd number vintages for some reason. We have 2011, 2013, and 2015. And 2000-something.
Ooh,
thank you. Well, these are, that's a gentleman bearing gifts. That works, huh?
Hey, Mike.
Yes.
What, those aren't private tasting?
No. Private
reserve. This is graft, pure graft. Washington influence. All right.
What do we want to try first?
Well, why don't we
want to do the fresh 2015?
We'll start with the youngest first?
Yeah, because the older get the flavor.
All right. We're going to start with the 2015.
So we made this. This cider we made last year, it was a barrel from Heaven Hill Distilleries in Kentucky. The barrel was a little dry when we got it, and also quite expensive. I think it was $250. Paul and I used to drive down to Kentucky in a pickup truck and get barrels from different distilleries. And some distilleries would give them to us for nothing. Some would charge us $10. For a barrel, and we would come back with the pickup truck that have barrels lashed all over it, and we'd come back and we'd sell some of the barrels to local cider makers to kind of cover our costs from going down there, and we would make the cider. So we stopped doing that because the price of gas got expensive, and I got rid of my pickup truck and got, you know, a sedan.
And don't forget, once you're out of Pennsylvania, you're in West Virginia.
So after about three or four trips, we decided not to do that anymore. And you can get barrels shipped up here. It's quite a bit more money, but it saves the aggravation of going through West Virginia. And so this barrel, we added a 750 milliliter of bourbon to it because the barrel was dry. We added 50 gallons of Pine Hill Orchard juice, 20 pounds of sugar, cane sugar, 8 pounds of brown sugar, 15 pounds of honey, and a brewer's sock full of raisins. And we let it ferment. We put it up in November. We let it ferment all winter long, all spring. At some point, probably about February, the fermentation stopped because Paul has a three-sided cellar, stone cellar, and it gets quite cold down there. And the fermentation in the barrel stopped, and along about the end of March, first part of April, it started fermenting again. And in the end of August this year, we bottled it.
So that is...
Now, what you can taste is a lot of barrel fermented beers, and they say barrel ciders that are not fermented in a cider in a barrel. They're actually fermented in stainless, and then they transfer the cider into a barrel to age. Because commercial cideries or breweries, you know, time is money, and if the cider is sitting in a barrel for months like ours is, that's going to cost some money. What they'd rather do is get it fermented fast, 3 weeks, put it in the barrel for a couple weeks, and then bottle it. You get a different taste, a softer taste, a rounder taste from fermenting in the barrel. As the cider ferments, all those little bubbles and the change in temperature, the cider will go in and out of the staves and keep drawing flavor out of there. The cider, the barrel makers, the bourbon people say there are two bottles of bourbon in every barrel of cider.
It's soaked into the wood.
Yeah, and you can really taste it. You get that oak, you get the sweet vanilla nose, and you get the bourbon taste. Now, I've had ciders that have been aged in barrels that have held other spirits similar, like whiskey, and you don't get that nice round sweet taste that you get from a bourbon barrel. You get it was a Scotch barrel, and you get that real dry, peaty smoky taste that you get out of scotch. It was interesting, but I really preferred the bourbon. You know, I like the American whole thing about it, and I like that sweet under taste. Yes, sir.
So you never rack it off the leaves?
Correct.
Never.
Well, no, it seems that the fact that we use so much honey, has little pieces, little particles, and we've read, you can't really see it, that helps it in clarifying it, because as those particles fall, other particles are attracted to it. So you have actually a real nice yeast cake at the bottom, and you can tell from some of these bottles that have not been shaken up yet, it's really clear. It gets very, very clear.
This one was clear, but it's been bounced around in the back of the car, and
see, like
there
this,
was a little bit in the bottom.
I mean, this one even you can see. That's just
super.
Could you read
brilliant.
The ingredients again
brilliant.
While they showed that? Could you read the ingredients again?
Okay. Do you want the total amount or just the ingredients?
No, the amount that was.
Okay, it's 20 pounds of white sugar. Now this is in a 53 gallon.
So 53 gallons is the size of the cake?
They're all roughly 53 gallons. Okay. Some a little more, some a little less. Every barrel is different because they're all handmade. So it's 20 pounds of cane sugar and 8 pounds of brown sugar, 15 pounds of honey, and a brewer's sock full of raisins. And usually what we do is we'll drop that in, we'll tie it off with a piece of floss, drop it in and then leave the floss outside and then put the water lock in to hold the brewer's sock so it doesn't rest on the bottom.
Yes?
Pardon my addition, it's something which needs no additions, but in terms of adding honey, I did a bunch of mead in glass, of course, this year with the top of a bulk 5 gallon bucket of raw honey from Merrimack Apiary. I mean, you get it anywhere, and it does that. That is the sediment from the raw beeswax just pulls everything down.
Yep. Yep.
So that top layer of honey is great for this.
Yep. And it's funny because it will, you know, you'll keep thiefing it because it'll finish fermenting, and then you'll keep thiefing it, and it'll come up and it's still not clear. And then all of a sudden, bam! It just, I don't know if it's a certain temperature it hits or if it decides, and everything within a week just falls brilliantly clear, just like this. Yes.
Are you guys doing a wild ferment or are you adding this?
It depends. Usually we add D47 because we like that yeast. But we've also done it with English cider yeast. We've had a barrel that we did with wild yeast. It was another Pine Hill blend. And it was fermenting by the time we got it home. So we just went, well, let's just leave it and see what we get. It was very good.
It was excellent. Now, was that the gold?
Depends on what year.
Or the 11. So is that the English cider or the? I don't take notes. And this was 5 years.
The gold cap in 11, I believe, was the wild yeast, and the silver cap is the English cider yeast.
Okay, so what happened is we came back from Pine Hill with these 5 gallon plastic containers, and we had 10 of them. Okay, half of them were already fermenting. At that point, you know, you're ready to put the yeast in, and the cider's going, yeah, we're already here. We've taken over this territory, you're not coming in. And there was nothing you could have done, so, well, no, we made 2 barrels that year.
Yes, we made 2 barrels that year.
2 barrels, so we had 25-gallon containers, and half of them were already kind of going. So we used the same recipe with the same juice. One had wild yeast, one had D47. Both were very, very good. The best cider was when we blended the two. Because we got all the different flavors of the wild yeast, plus that nice D47 flavor profile that accentuated some of the fruit.
Madman Medico was the one who discovered that.
Yes, because he didn't make it, he didn't get enough of each, so we poured it together. Yeah, Madman. So actually, that's the... Oh, let's try that one first. So this is the Wild Yeast 2011.
We think, because we don't keep notes. Generally, probably somewhere between 12 and 14% alcohol, because of all the sugars that we add to it. But because of the bourbon and the vanillins and all the other flavors that we pick up from the barrel, it tends to be pretty balanced and not too hot.
Yeah. This one tends to have a little bit of oxidation in it, which makes it taste a little sherry, which is not unpleasant.
So this was a wild one?
Yes, this is a wild one, 2011.
Quick mechanical question for you.
Sure.
Those raisins swell up in the sock. How do you get
the
sock? How do you get the sock out of the bun without just tearing the crap out of it?
You don't. You
so then, why bother putting it in the sock?
Because when you siphon it or pump it out, the raisins get in.
Okay.
The pump.
So you deal with the sock and the raisins.
You deal with the sock later, because we in the past have done that. Just dump the raisins in, and when you try to siphon it, the raisins get stuck in the siphon tube.
And then, what are you using to clean your barrels?
A hose.
So, but you just invert them and
just volume. Squirt it. Paul was laying in the mud, looking up inside of it with a flashlight, spraying it with a hose.
Okay.
Now you just spray it, rock it back and forth, dump it out, spray it, rock it back and forth, dump it out.
Now, we did have a gentleman question. He said, how often do you reuse the barrels? We've never reused a barrel, except this year we snoozed and we lost, and we didn't get a barrel. So we're going to use the barrel from last year. It's all cleaned out. We're going to re-moisten it with some bourbon, roll it around, pour a bottle of bourbon in there, roll it around, and try it and see what happens. Okay. Charlie Wachowski has made some, and you do still get some of that bourbon barrel characteristic. Do you get as much as a fresh barrel? No, you don't, because, you know, you get a lot of the taste winds up in the cider, and it's no longer in the barrel. Mm-hmm. So we'll see. Same bad time, same bad station. You'll see it next
if
year.
If you're extracting, or you know, the liquid inside is extracting from the barrel throughout the fermentation process. What if you just add more? You said you didn't add like a fifth of bourbon. What if you add like two bottles of bourbon?
Call me.
Use up one before you make cider.
Yeah.
I remember. So I make cider at a place in Sherburn professionally. We've done a couple of barrel ferments, but we never reuse the barrels.
Yeah.
I'm always worried about sort of the leaves going bad in it. Or
correct.
Whenever I ferment in tank and then put stuff in a barrel, I'm a little more confident that I can reuse that barrel, because I use my bourbon barrels for neutral vessels later on. And I'm not able to do this, but you guys might be able to. If you do your first ferment at like 11%, you get like not quite as much barrel flavor. But the difference between 11 and 13% extracts way more from the wood. And I know that because I went to this Long Trail. They had two different barrel aged things. One was very mild and one was very strong. And I said, which one gets the first use barrels? And the stronger one was actually the second use barrels. But they increased the alcohol to 16% for the extraction. And then they reduced it down with the lower ABV beers, but kept more of the barrel. So you might be able to get more out of your barrels if you go from lower alcohol to higher alcohol when you're using those.
Too late now! It's already in there. But that's you see, that's things you pick up at these seminars, at these workshops. Well, there you go. And that would explain a lot of the, because it's alcohol soluble. Does taste come in because of the alcohol? It scrubs that inside of the barrel. Yeah. So you can taste a little oxidation on this. This is 5 years old. Even though we'd had some problems with European size caps not holding properly. That's not the case, but this tastes a little older than the last one. This is 2013. Now, for the barrel ciders, we've always used pine hill juice. It has that little, that means it is sparkling.
I'm not dead yet.
Nice little foamy head on it. Just about perfect.
Just about perfect.
All right.
Wow, that's hokey.
Okay.
I have a basic, I don't know what I'm talking about question. So I'm a beekeeper, but I'm not an apple cider brewer yet, although I have many apple trees. Question about why do the barrel fermentation? Is it to try to get the flavors that we're tasting here?
Yes.
That's the whole purpose?
That is the purpose.
Okay.
Is for the flavor profile.
Okay.
Yeah. No, because otherwise we could just ferment in carboys. And,
okay.
You know, you have... I mean, I've made a barrel cider recipe using oak chips soaked in bourbon, done it in a carboy. It's really good, but it's not barrel cider.
Yeah. And the flavors you're getting out of it, you're getting, remember they char the inside,
right.
And that chars the natural sugars. So that the caramel and vanilla taste and the nose, that's from the wood and the char. You get the bourbon taste that's from what they fermented in there. The same way when I had the cider that was fermented in the whiskey barrel, you got the taste of the whiskey in the cider.
It was a Jack Daniel's barrel, wasn't it?
The whiskey one?
Yeah.
No. That would have tasted similar to this because it's corn. This was an actual, it was made in Boston, but it was a whiskey. So they used malted barley, and you got all those smoky notes, and it was dry tasting rather than sweet. Bourbon tends to be sweeter than whiskey or scotch or anything like that.
And you're going to get, like a single barrel bourbon, you're going to get a different flavor profile with every barrel you use.
Yeah,
because of
you
variations.
Are. We actually did at one point get some very old barrels that had held bourbon for 15 to 18 years.
Yeah.
And we found that the best, the prime barrel cider was the 7-year-old barrel, because as the whiskey ages, it evaporates. And in fact, you go in the warehouses, and that's all you can smell is bourbon. And when they get down to about 15 to 18 years, there's only a half a barrel of whiskey in there. And so when we tried that, we thought, oh, this is going to be great. This is really the nice old whiskey. But the top of the barrel's all dried out, and we didn't get the flavors that we liked. So we found that the 7-year-old barrel was
the prime.
Best
for us.
Probably easier to get your hands on too.
Well, they didn't used to be hard to get, but they used to give them to us.
Yeah. Well, we also used to show up. This is funny. We'd drive all the way there, and we'd have the pickup truck, and it wasn't. You know, the fancy schmancy pickup truck.
Yeah,
and we would pack two coolers full of barrel cider that we had made out of their bourbon barrel. So we'd show up and they'd go, the Yankee boys are here, the Yankee boys are here. And we'd say, no, we're a Red Sox fan. But we would call ahead of time, and the cider, barrel master would take, because what they do, they empty the barrels and individually, and then blend the bourbon and bottle it. And he would chalk mark, we said we're coming up for 6 barrels, he would chalk mark, he said these are the barrels he wants.
And by law, they are supposed to rinse the barrels with water. Federal law, they're supposed to rinse the barrels with water after they empty all the bourbon out of it. But because they knew when we were coming, they would save barrels for us that they didn't rinse.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we'd be like, we'd turn them over.
Yeah, tongue trick on it.
So we'd go there, and typically it would be in the summer, and you know Kentucky gets rather warm in the summer, and they would stop work on the shop floor, and they go, they're here, and we'd start drinking. They loved this stuff, absolutely loved it, and then we would go with the cellar master to thief samples of straight 130 proof bourbon.
Did you bring another driver with you?
No, we usually wound up like that in the truck in the parking lot for a couple hours.
They took us up in the tasting room where they did all the professional tasting when they wanted to blend their whiskeys. And they said, oh, we're going to have you try our different whiskeys. And they laid out probably 15 glasses of bourbon for us to try. We're,
we did our best to represent our region, but we failed miserably. But they really did like our cider.
Yeah,
it was good stuff. So any comments on the differences between these? The 11 you found dry, a little sherried. The latest one, the 15, I thought was a little sweeter. The 13 was a little less sweet because it still evolves in there and it's still changing.
Yeah, 13 is like oak and fizz.
So, you know, the barrel thing. You know, Kentucky, I mean, it goes really hot and then really cold. You know, your three-sided cellar, I mean, that's pretty cold, at least all during the fermentation period, right?
Yep.
So there's no in and out, well, and by the next spring.
I think what we get that in and out when we do the primary fermentation in the barrel, because that's very violent. And I think that
generates a little heat.
Generates heat, and I think that because of the violence of it, it pushes into the wood and then pulls back out as the violent fermentation dies down. And also at some point during the winter it stops fermenting. It just stops and it's still. And then when the weather warms up, it starts fermenting again.
Right.
But during primary, usually, you know, you've got weather that's not too bad when we get the juice from here. We've had some pretty mild cider days.
Yeah.
And what we'll do is, to melt all the sugars, we'll take 7 or 8 gallons of cider and put it in a stock pot.
Where's the genius at now?
All right, I'll take it, Tom's. Thank you. Are you laughing at my belching?
No, laughing at what that time that we were trying to pump the sugar.
All right.
So,
we're trying to. We did it at my house because everybody's like, I'm not doing this at my house. So we tried. So we tried to pump. We mixed this hot liquid that had, 50 pounds of sugar. It had honey, it had sugar, it was thick. We had a pump.
And hot,
and we were trying to pump it upstairs.
No, we were pumping it from, because we didn't want to bring all the cider, because we had 15 gallons.
You tell this story.
All right, here's the story. This was before we got the 5-gallon jug, so all we had were 15-gallon stainless steel jugs, you know, containers, beer kegs. And they get heavy, and we didn't want to take them down to Paul's cellar because we couldn't, lift them up or anything. They were just very heavy. So we thought that we would, you know, just bring it into his living room, and we would pump it down into the barrel. And that worked pretty good. We got it down into the barrel, but we had to get
8 gallons
of this really thick, hot, syrupy stuff to you know, the 20 pounds of sugar and the brown sugar and all this, and the honey. And it was in a 10-gallon container?
Stainless steel stock pot.
Stainless steel stock pot. So this was the last thing. And I said, all right, go down there and watch the barrel to see if it's going to overflow. Put the wand in the 10-gallon stock pot, and I turned the pump on, and because it was so hot, it swelled the plastic on the end of the pump, and it blew off, and it was spraying all over my... dripping down the floors.
So I've got wide pine floors that don't have much thing in between, and we have a very... We call him Shakespeare. He has white hair, and he's downstairs looking to make sure that it's not overflowing, and there's goo coming through the floorboards. And he says, oh, I think you better come down here. It's overflowing from the ceiling. Now, there are still spots, sticky spots, in my living room. that I haven't gotten to yet. But everybody thinks it's
Don't try this at home.
Don't try this at home.
Because you're professionals.
That's why you were laughing.
That's why I was laughing. That's I remember that vividly.
Yes, that blew a gasket on the pump. Yes.
So you must use a different, I make 5 gallons.
A different process now, yes.
Do you use a different thing than a pump siphon? Like, what do you use to siphon out of your, generally, you said a few.
Well, now we put it in 5 gallons.
Okay.
We bring them next to the cellar, next to the barrel, and use the pump to pump it. You know,
is it the same kind of pump that you would use?
No, this is an electric pump.
This is electric,
pump,
okay.
Because we make up to 150 gallons of wine a year, too, and ferment in 15 gallons stainless, kegs.
Right.
And it's just easier at that point to pump it from one to another if you've got a rack or something.
Right, okay.
But, do not try this at home.
And what about sterilizing? Are you
The barrel or
whatever you're using? Or
we use standard things you'd use to sterilize or sanitize, really, sterilize. To sanitize any, if you're a brewer, you can either use metabisulfite if you're a winemaker or bleach or bleach solution that we use. And, the main thing, of course, is to keep everything clean and rinse after you use it and then sanitize it. In a bleach or a metabisulfite.
I've only used boiling water, and I've only made one bad of bad wine in the last 10 years or something.
Yep, boiling water.
If you're careful, you can.
Yeah, you can use 100. You've got to get it to a certain temperature. And there's a whole scale at 160, X
exactly
amount of seconds, 180, X amount of seconds.
Thermometer.
Yep, that's very efficient. Okay. It works. So. Yes.
How much do you leave any space in the barrel, or is it all the way to the top?
Well, it depends. Sometimes we'll fill it all the way up to the top and use a blow-off tube for some of the scum. And that's as simple as imagine a bung that you would put, in a carboy, and just put a little stem in a tube that goes from there into a glass. Okay, so we usually use a 1 gallon plastic
milk jug,
fill it half with bleach solution, put the blow off tube in there. What's going to happen? You'll see all the scum, all the brown stuff coming from the cider being pushed by the fermentation. It'll come out and blub, 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 into the 1 gallon plastic filled halfway with sanitizing solution. So all that scum is actually winding up in there, and it cleanses the cider. So you can fill the barrel up to the top and do that, or leave some headspace. You can actually leave it open at that point, maybe put a little cheesecloth or something on top, because there's so much CO2 coming off that this air that has things that will turn that into cider vinegar can't get in. So you can leave it open, and then as it settles down, top it off with fresh cider and put your water lock on there. So during go ahead.
In colonial times, they didn't have rubber stoppers and stuff. They would just let it foam up, and then the foam would harden, and that would prevent organisms from getting in. Yeah.
So during primary fermentation, there's so much stuff coming off, you really don't have to worry about it. After a month or so or 3 weeks, when that settles down, that's when you really want to keep your cider away from air. So you'd put your water lock on or some kind of device that lets the CO2 still come out without letting this air get in.
Do they make special airlocks for barrels?
Yep, it's a size 11.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's a size 11 bung.
Yeah.
And then you can just use a regular water lock. But we use a blow-off tube to begin with, because it'll just blow right through a regular water lock. Right.
So
but once the fermentation settles down, it's a regular water lock.
It's bigger than 5 gallons.
Yeah,
like,
5 gallon, I think it's a 6 or 6.5 number, and this is an 11.
Okay.
But, you can buy them in a store.
For primary fermentation temperature ranges, for winemaking, it sounds like it's a lot warmer than what you guys are.
Well, we do it in the cellar, and right now it's generally in the high 50s, low 60s. But again, coming back to before Steve started laughing, the fact that we boil up all this liquid, all the sugars, and put it in there raises the temperature of the must to start.
Yeah.
And I always use, people say, well, how many packets of yeast do you put in? I only use one packet of yeast, but I do it for 5 gallons. So I will put a packet of yeast in a 5 gallon carboy, filled maybe 4 gallons, put a water lock on there. That'll get going. So I'll have 4 gallons of really fermenting juice, and then the other juice and the sugar will be in the barrel, and we can siphon or just hand pour with a funnel that stuff in, and it goes within 6 to 8 hours, it's going.
So you make a super starter.
We make a super starter, and the must after the warm sugar's been going in is warm. Once your fermentation is going, it generates its own heat. It's hard to get cold juice going. You want to warm it up first, and once it gets going, and again, D47 is, we use it a lot because it goes from 45 to 75, but even some of the warmer yeast, like beer yeast
or champagne
yeast, that say they work best between 60 and 75. Once you get it going, they'll keep chugging along. They'll keep chugging along. Plus, remember, you've got all that wood. It's insulated. It's insulated and it will prevent it from getting really hot or really cold. What you don't want is this. This is fine. Like what Steve said, in the coldest of winter, when the cellar gets low 40s, sometimes high 30s, if we have a really cold winter, the fermentation will... It won't stop, but there's no visible, you'll look in, you don't see any bubbles, and there's no bubbles coming up through the water lock. In the spring, when it warms up a little bit, that'll start going again. It's alive. It's a live product, and it reacts very much to the seasons. So.
You don't cork it and roll it around.
No, I don't do that.
No.
That could be another story.
And another thing, put your barrel where you want your barrel.
Oh, yeah.
You're not going to move
it. You're not going to move it. Once it gets going, that's a lot.
You have a question?
Yeah, I think I remember your recipe contains white sugar, brown sugar, raisins, and honey. Mm-hmm. And how did you arrive at that, at your recipe? When did you say, I think we need some raisins?
Originally, when we first were introduced to barrel cider, it was from a fellow named Bert Lind, who grew up in Coleraine. And he's now 95. Still alive, still kicking, and he's a local guy in Pepperell, and he made barrel cider, and we were introduced to his barrel cider, and Paul, being the chef that he is, came up with a recipe that was very similar, but not quite as rugged as what Bert's cider was. Bert's cider used wild yeast, and molasses, and that was it. Yeah, he used non-sulfated molasses, and it was pretty rugged, and he just left it in the barrel, and as he wanted it, he had a barrel tap, and he would just, take out what he wanted and just leave it on the cradle. And, he would first start pouring it off in, March or something like that. By the time September rolled around, it was almost like vinegar. But he didn't notice because he drank it every day, and it was tough to drink. So Paul kind of modified the recipe, and that's where we came up with the recipe that we have that works.
I would think it would take longer to ferment because it has the honey in it, like that's slower to ferment.
Yes, the honey.
The sugar would be faster, right?
Yes.
Is that why it went that long too? Do you think?
Probably, yeah. There's a lot of sugars there to ferment.
Yeah, yeah.
And it does. There's a large volume, but yes, indeed, the honey is a very complex sugar, and it takes a lot longer to ferment it out.
Dang.
Yeah.
Which one is this? This is a little bit older. Is this a 12?
We don't have a 12, Steve. We have an 11, a 13, and a 15. I would suspect that this is the 11.
Okay, yeah, because it's got that molasses. It's got that molasses.
When you use the honey, do you shoot for a particular, like a fall honey or a spring honey? Is the fall honey a stronger flavor? That effective?
We get whatever we can get.
We have a friend of ours who's who has bees, and his portion of the barrel is proportional to how much honey he can spare for us. and that works out for us, you know, local honey.
Twice we made the barrel cider with honey only as the sugar, and we left it in the barrel for 18 months.
Yeah, until it sprung a leak.
Yeah. And then we bottled it.
Yeah.
So that was the barrel sizer.
Yeah. We don't have any of that.
Oh,
that's yeah. Why we don't have any of it.
Yeah, the barrel sizer was very good. It was very, and it was extremely clear. It was really good. And we arrived at this recipe because brown sugar on its own gives you a lot of off flavors when it ferments because of the molasses. But we like kind of the little funkiness of it, so we dialed that bit down. The honey being rather expensive, we didn't add 50 pounds of honey because it's kind of pricey. Yeah. So it was like, well, you know, we wanted a nice balance of things and figured it out and worked it out over the years. And that works for us. It gives a nice round taste without any of the sugars being too overpowering. And the white sugar just jacks the alcohol up.
What caused the barrel to fail? I heard someone else make a comment about it, ride it through, but what caused the barrel to fail?
We don't know. It just started leaking one day.
And we can just...
Oh, a seepage. Okay.
Yeah. Right. So for whatever reason, we don't know, but we tried plugging it up. And
it spoke to you.
Yeah.
It's time. Drink me.
Because typically when you make a sizer, a barrel sizer, you want to leave it for 2 years. Right. And this was 18 months, and it was just, you know, they were starting to get bugs on it and stuff.
Yeah. So we decided, time to bottle. Yes.
What kind of raisins do you like to use?
We use just regular California non-sulfided raisins. Traditionally, this was an addition to New England barrel cider because those are essentially little pellets of sugar. And in the winter, you put it on just to keep the fermentation going so the yeast wouldn't just totally stop working before it was totally bone dry. Yes.
So how do you know when you're done? Is it clear? Is that what you're saying? It's
clear. Yep. Clear. We sample it all year long.
But
did you ever top it up?
No. But the samples, I mean, we literally, it's very tempting to take big drinks of it as you're sampling, but we take literally, you know, this much. You go, okay, it's ready or it's not ready. You don't want to do that every time you increase the air space in there, there's a possibility that you get contamination from bacteria, fungus, or viruses in the air. And it's done not when the taste is done, but when it clears.
So use a thief.
Use a thief, and you can just go, okay, it's not clear yet. Okay. When it's clear, it's done.
So if you do top it off, how much longer do you have to wait?
Well, if you're going to top it off, if your cider's almost finished and it tastes dry but it's not clear yet, late in the season, I would be reluctant to add sweet cider because that sugar is going to start the fermentation of it.
Right.
So you
can stir it up.
Yeah. So you can either use dry fermented cider from previous years or boiled in cooled water. I mean, really, if you're going to add a quart to 50 gallons, you're not going to taste the difference of a quart of water diluting it.
Mm. Probably best to use distilled water too, as opposed to tap water. That won't, the distilled water won't add any minerals or flavors to it.
Got to keep that chlorine away from the wood.
Yeah, absolutely.
There you go.
So your sediment in the bottom, is it really 18 months, 2 years, is it really packed tight?
It's pretty tight. Not super tight. It's kind of like mud.
Yeah, it's mud.
It's not gelatinous or anything.
So just be really careful when you start packing it.
We usually start our pump. And the siphon, the pump suction end is up.
Right.
And then we'll lower it, and, you know, it's clear, too. And we'll lower it till you can see it pick up the must on the bottom, and then you just pick it up a little bit and pump it till it's done.
But I think we usually get out of a 52-gallon barrel, 48 gallons.
Wow.
Because by that time, remember, after it's fermented, it's soaked back into the wood a little bit. You can lose some there. And just, you know, you're never going to get it totally filled. And you're going to have a little bit on the bottom, probably a gallon and a half on the bottom. So we generally get 48 gallons out of a 52-gallon barrel.
of clear cider.
Do you have any problems with spoilage and mold and fungus? And you can't see it, so...
No. We haven't. We haven't. The barrels are fresh. If not, you know, you throw some bourbon in there. And the acidity of the juice and the alcohol content tends to keep, so far, everything at bay.
You're not sanitizing after, you're just pouring by the bourbon.
Yes. Yes.
So I have a small 10-gallon barrel. It's just charred, intended for whiskey. How long would it take to, you know, to get the bourbon to...
Not long, because you have, when you take a smaller barrel, yeah, your surface area is much larger in relation to the amount of to the volume.
Right.
And so, probably would want, if you want that bourbon flavor, I wouldn't add a lot of bourbon to it, because it's such a small barrel.
Right.
I mean, the barrel was dry, we added 1.75 milliliters of bourbon to it. So if you reduce that down, you're looking at, you know,
less than 75 liters. Liters.
Yeah, liters.
Two bottles.
Two bottles.
If you have a new barrel, you've never pulled all the tannin out into a liquor. And if you ferment in a brand new barrel, particularly a small one, you might get an overwhelmingly tannic.
So. Oh, yeah. I don't know in a small barrel if you want to ferment in a small barrel.
Yeah.
I'd use that for
conditioning
and then taste it. I would think that you would get a lot of flavor out of a couple of weeks in a five.
Well, what about what Randy did with his?
Oh yeah. Well, you can explain that. That's.
We have a package store in town. And the guy has a wonderful selection of microbrews and ciders. The guy has a great selection, but we have a local brewer in Lowell called Navigation Brewing. And he had Navigation make a chocolate porter, and he put it in a 7-gallon barrel, charred barrel that had been used for
whiskey,
and he left it in there for 6 or 7 months.
Way too long.
And the stuff was just not good.
Yep.
It was just way over the top. But he was like, oh, this is great. No, it's not. But yeah, he was happy with it.
And one of my lines in this is, you know, it's what I do for a living, and it's with this. It's all about balance. Balance, 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 balance. You know, you make a beer, oh, a little hops is good, a lot of hops is better. No, that's why now you've seen in a very short time people moving away from all the monster IPAs. In the wine business, was the same thing for years. It was, well, monsters inns, big tannic things that you couldn't drink with anything, you couldn't enjoy. It was an expression in excess. You know, and now, you know, they blend grapes and make it pleasant to drink. Same thing. You know, too much bourbon, too much alcohol is not a good thing.
Some of the high alcohol wines in California, they're running the wine through reverse osmosis, and they're pulling water and alcohol out, and then they separate the alcohol and the water, and they put the water back in, and it brings the alcohol level down and the wine down to, you know, 12 to 13%, and they don't have to advertise that they added water,
right?
Because they're taking the water out and they're putting it back in. They just minus the alcohol, and it makes it more palatable. We've done that with the wine that we make, because sometimes we get raisins, and it makes a real high alcohol, and it's not pleasant to drink. So we add distilled water, and it brings it down to, you know, 13-14%, and it's quite pleasant.
In drought years, you know, we've had, not this year, but there have been a number of previous years in California where they've had just no rain, and as Steve said, the grapes come in and, you know, potential alcohol for white wine, 16% alcohol, and we processed that and made the wine before, and it's not good. It's just, it's hot, it's too strong, so we've added water to make it, to dilute it some, to make it pleasant, so we don't have, you know, summer guests crawling from the wreckage of our house, passed out on the front lawn.
Yes, like you've done. Remember that port that we made? No, you don't remember the port we made.
The only time I blacked out was with our port. And my present wife prohibited me from drinking it in her presence. Anybody here made barrel cider?
Not yet.
Good. Well, you get, yes.
Does it matter what kind of wood they're using to make the barrel then?
Absolutely.
So are they using a specific kind to make?
They use white oak.
They're using white oak. Okay, yeah. So it is pretty high in tannins then.
They char.
Okay.
But some of the, I know that they do make some barrels out of chestnut, which is neutral. And also out of
chestnut, though, is usually for big primary fermenters. They're called foudre in French. They're huge, and they use chestnut for that because it's prior to stainless steel and all that. That was the cheapest way to make a big fermenter for wine.
So you wouldn't want it to be a new white oak barrel?
No. If you're aging, for example, a heavy red wine in a French oak barrel, you can really taste the oak, and they'll put Chardonnay in there for a shorter amount of time. Cider, remember, is very delicate.
Yeah.
With the natural sugar in there, you're talking about a beverage that may have 5% alcohol, and is a very delicate. You can't throw it into something that's so strong. Well, you could, but...
Won't taste good.
And you have to put it in and pull it out in such a short amount of time that it wouldn't be worth the expense of a white oak barrel, because they're not cheap. You're better off actually using chips if you want to do that, which is an inexpensive way to go.
I made one with that, and I soaked the chips in bourbon and then used a brewer's sock and took the regular recipe and just reduced it for a 5-gallon batch. It didn't taste like barrel cider, but it was very good.
Yeah, it was very good.
It was very good. In fact, it never made it to cider day.
Nope. It got sidetracked. Thank you.
So how do you clean the barrels out when you're done?
Just a hose. Just squirt water into it and then roll it back and forth and dump it out and then roll it back up and spray it again. Takes about, 45 minutes or so of rinsing.
Yeah, you could stainless steel chain toss in there.
Yep, just bang it around. You could use a power washer, but mind you, by the time we finish, when we bottle our barrel cider, it's July?
August.
And the new stuff is coming in a couple months later, so it isn't sitting for a long time empty. We bung it up, put a bung back in it, and we just went to see if the barrel was okay that we used the year before. Just pop the bung out and stick your nose in there. If it smells fresh, I mean, there's a contamination or a microbe, you can smell it.
Yep.
You can smell
so
it.
So there's no other way of curing it, just rinsing it with water?
Well, there are books that say you can put a light sulfite solution and roll it around in there, or burn sulfur strips.
Yeah. And somebody once said that you can take some of the bands off the top and then take the lid out and then really clean it on the inside and then put it back together again. But that seems like a lot.
Yeah.
And it may not come back together well.
And if you wake up smelling something before you go to put your next bottle of cider in that you don't think is right, just throw it out.
And what it'll smell like is it'll smell vinegary. You'll get a sharp...
Yeah.
That's the first thing. That is the most common contaminant. You'll get...
So then you're done. That's like
you're done. You're like, cut it in half and plant it.
That's your...
And it won't go away. Once it's in there... Don't mess around. It's like, no.
Yes. I thought your starting position was don't reuse your barrels.
You're saying use from whiskey, right? You're not saying a reused barrel. You're saying a barrel that was emptied from whiskey or bourbon
right.
to when you start.
Right.
Not a reused cider barrel.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So you're talking about just cleaning the whiskey barrel? No.
No,
I'm confused.
No.
Okay.
Last year, we used this barrel, and it was a whiskey barrel. It was
bourbon
barrel. And it wasn't that fresh. Nobody had used it for anything, but it had dried out. So we added two 750 milliliter bottles of whiskey to it, rolled it around, let it soaked up, and it made it nice and wet again. And then we put the cider in it. And then we are going to reuse it again this year because we were too cheap to buy a new one. They get very expensive.
Right. But your position was, if the best,
the best,
whatever you said,
don't reuse your already used
for
fermenting cider, previously used bourbon barrels. Use it once, and then you're
done. That's what we've always done.
If you want to play it safe.
So next
year
we'll
got the money to buy another.
Yeah. Next year we'll find out.
We'll find out.
Next year we'll find out if we are successful or not.
If we are geniuses or not. But we did to follow up on that, we did wash the barrel out right after we finished it, bunged it up, and last week we gave it a good sniff and it smelled sweet.
Yeah, we both stuck our noses
in. So it was like, okay, let's give it a try. It won't taste like this, but we've had bourbon barrel cider reused, and it's close.
Okay.
So, well, let's give it a shot.
So what do you do with the rest of the barrel once you're done every year?
We cut them up and make planters out of them.
Make planters.
Whole driveway lined with planters.
So once your cider is cleared, it's time to bottle.
Yep.
Don't leave it in there like.
You can leave it in there.
Yeah, but we have a friend who.
Chris.
Oh. He revisits the tragedy of running out of cider. And it was always like, is it ready? Is it ready? Is it ready? So we can't keep it in there longer because he's out. And his wife is very demanding of this cider. So he says, so to keep the domestic tranquility, when he runs out of cider and the cider's ready, that's generally when you bottle.
It's an enabler.
Yes. Are you married?
Yes.
Okay, so you understand.
Yeah, yeah, really.
Happy wife, happy life. There you go.
You wouldn't wash out a barrel that you got, a bourbon barrel.
No.
Other than add whiskey.
Because remember,
bourbon.
It's charred, it's had bourbon in it,
right.
There's nothing growing in that.
It should be good.
Yeah.
Have you ever experimented with barrels used for anything besides bourbon or whiskey? I mean, there's some other liquors.
We did one once that was used for Applejack Calvados.
Yep.
Yeah.
A Laird's.
Ooh. Mm-hmm.
That was pretty good.
That was pretty good.
I'll say I have no idea how you get one, but I've seen a few whiskeys that are finished in Sauternes casks.
Yes.
And I thought, I don't know how you'd find one, but I would love to taste a barrel cider.
There's a whole market in used barrels, and it used to be that the law is in Kentucky that you can only use a barrel in Kentucky to make bourbon once. And what they would do is, you know, we'd show up and they'd give it to us and go, you know, there's no market. A lot of them would go overseas, and Scotch manufacturers would. You know, people didn't realize that they aged their product in American bourbon barrels. And now, you know, these barrels are going to all places. And now, you know, we age it in Sauternes, we age it in red wine barrels, we age it. There's this whole other business that's grown out of cideries, wineries, and distilleries and breweries using used barrels. Hence the $250 price tag instead of the free or $30.
Right.
So
and the brewers. The 2,400-mile round trip. Right?
Yes. Yes. You get through Pennsylvania. There's a lot of Italians there, so the food's still good. Once you get through West Virginia, you're on your own. It's not so good.
Crack a lunch. The best Italian restaurant in town.
Good barbecue.
Papa Gino's.
No, they don't even have those. It's all chain restaurants. Are we done?
This up? Yeah, any other questions? If not, we're going to wrap this up. Yes, sir.
I have a question. In terms of the juice that you get, do you just use blended juice, or do you ever shoot for a varietal, like try to get a particular kind of apple juice?
We've always used juice from Pine Hill, one of their Cider Day blends.
Yeah.
Although this year, because of the lack of apples everywhere, we suspect that a lot of the apples are coming from places a little farther away that are still perfectly okay upstate New York. So we're opting, and we had lack of space in our vehicles this year. We're going to get our juice for our second run bourbon barrel cider from New England Apple Products in Leominster that presses American, you know, dessert apples from everywhere around here. So we're getting it from closer to home rather than from Pine Hill this year.
I talked to Matt. Matt said most of his came from
like North New Hampshire.
Really?
Really.
Yep.
Do you know what the winery farms are versus?
What? No, from New England apple products, no idea.
Whatever they can get, right?
Yeah, but they don't even know. It's just their apples.
Yeah, but this time of year, remember, you're in a prime apple growing area. Even the orchard blend is going to be far superior to what anybody else can get. I mean, the fruit ciders you had yesterday, those were all New England apple products, regular orchard run. That's you know, really well balanced and really good.
On that topic though, you have any like advice for making good cider with non cider apples?
Yeah, just
have you ever
the only ciders we've had that are on their own are not, they're not bad, but they're not, you know, memorable. Is made some early season out of Max and Paul Reds. And that tended to be, was all right.
Yeah, it's one dimensional. The best advice is to use later season apples, because the earlier season apples tend to be a little one dimensional. They're more Macintosh, which is more aroma. They're sweet, but there's not a lot of guts to them. Any of these mills now pressing apples are using a lot of late season apples, which tend to have a little more meat on their bones, so to speak.
Yeah, Cortland's and Baldwin's and
things like that, and Golden Delicious, not delicious, Golden Delicious. These are all very good, very excellent apples that, as a blend, make a better cider than any of them would individually.
So you're looking for a balance of your tannins and your acids and your sweet.
Yep, and generally, any mill around here or anywhere in New England is going to press a variety of apples that will give you all those components.
Yep.
It's, you know, we're fortunate that here we are.
You never add any like tannins or acids or anything?
No.
Like, you ever taste the juice and say like, I don't know?
No, we haven't. And I used to measure for all that. And every year it'd fall right within where it's supposed to. So we don't measure that anymore.
A lot of times we'll check the specific gravity, but that's about it.
Yeah.
And Charlie does us Charlie nuts, because we don't keep notes or anything. We just
make it.
We just make it. Usually, when was the last time we made a bad cider?
We drank it. I don't know. All right, well, thank you very much for coming. We'll see you next year. Thank you.